Good evening, everybody, and welcome back to Holden's 11. I got a terrific guest tonight, and I can't wait to talk to him. Please welcome Travis Gibb.
Hi!
Travis, it's great to see you, man. Great to see you.
It's great to see you, Tim. You're part of my crew. You're doing a whole bunch of stuff. It's glad to be on. I'm so excited to be on your show. I know we planned it like a month ago when I was doing one of holidays, whatever Kickstarter was that month. But I'm glad we're doing it now. I think we've got a great group of questions, so I'm excited.
Yeah, it's going to be a good one. And, you know, I'm so happy to have you. It's funny, we get wrapped up in our Kickstarters and stuff, and we kind of forget. You're kind of like me, where you have multiple projects juggling at any time. And right. At least for my case, you know, I don't have any kind of sophisticated scheduling process. I'm still kind of figuring it out as I go, if you know what I mean. So,
right.
But man, I'm thrilled to have you. And we have a terrific topic. Our topic tonight is the top 11 musicals. And I know you're a musical guy and I'm a musician as well. And first of all, I can't wait to talk to you about your song, which I really enjoyed. That's coming up later in the broadcast. But the first thing, just to alert the viewers, when I say the top 11 musicals, this is something that Travis and I came up with. It's not necessarily musicals in the purest sense of the word. What we have is musical properties that we both enjoy and that we feel have made an impact on our creations and have made an impact on pop culture as well. And with one or two small rules, one of the rules was I did bump out the Disney musical properties, not because I don't love them. I do. But there were so many that that's almost enough for its own list. Right. So and the second thing is it had to have at least three songs. Because some of these are going to be movies. And, you know, in my view, if you've got more than three songs in your movie, you got a musical there. Would you agree with that?
Oh, yeah. Well, especially if the characters are breaking into song. Like, There is ones that are kind of on the cusp where, like, there's, like, a soundtrack that plays that, like, echoes over, like, enough parts. But that's right. Not the same thing.
Yeah.
Specifically about people singing.
And, by the way, we got a couple of those. So, viewers, yeah. As always, please feel free to chime in and disagree with us. I kind of like when people disagree with me.
Right.
And that's the fun thing about these lists. We really just talk about things we love. And if anybody wants to add their thoughts, there's no wrong answers on the top 11. So with that in mind, let's launch right in to our number 11. This is from 2007. It's Across the Universe. So what'd you think of that when it came out?
Across the Universe is literally one of my favorite films. I have learned, because I didn't grow up loving the Beatles. I didn't grow up loving them. And I found, as I've grown up, I love the Beatles, but I don't always love the Beatles singing them, which is crazy to me. You know, I don't always love, not that the Beatles aren't one of the greatest rock bands of all time and that they're amazing singers, but I found, like, I loved, like, Come Together when Aerosmith sang it, you know, on one of their albums, you know. Yeah. And then that particular movie, there's a song in it. What is it called? I know the lyrics. I'm trying to think of what the name's called. You know, it's forget the time or place we just met. There's a girl for me and I, there's a girl to me. We met.
I've just seen a face.
I just seen a face. Yeah. That song I had never heard prior to Across the Universe. And that is the most I fell in love with someone's song ever. Like every first date, when you know that this one is going to be special, like those are the songs, the lyrics, the things that go in your head. It is crazy. And the way they do it, I was like, oh.
You know, it's funny. You picked one of my all time favorites as well. And that song in particular, when I first moved to Florida, as you know, I used to be a Floridian.
Right.
Just coming out of a messy divorce. And honestly, between you and I, depressed. Life was a mess. I had just lost everything, I thought.
Right.
And this guitar player reached out to me and he said, hey man, I heard that you are a bassist. We're looking for a bassist to sit in with our folk act. And it was like an Irish folk act, and they had two female singers and they were doing a rendition of I've Just Seen a Face. And I was like, I'm in, man, I'm in. And so you can make a pretty solid point that that song influenced the direction of my life, because that is what I heard and said, okay, I want to be in your act. And we did that for a couple of years. And of course, I got better and stuff. But, you know, music for me plays a kind of a very healing role. And that song is definitely part of it.
You know, I'm going to share something a little personal that's not on our list, but it's a music related. So I think
please do.
So when I went through my divorce, I went from not drinking at all, Tim, to like drinking every night. And I had a bunch of money and I was super lucky. So I had my daughter every other week and I didn't want my daughter knowing I was drinking. So I would go sober. I believe that I would have been an alcoholic if I didn't have that, like, love of my daughter is more important than drinking, right? So every other week I'd go cold turkey and then all on stuff. But I started really being fascinated with karaoke. Yeah. And as I was healing, getting better, I would every night sing Patience by Guns N' Roses, try to tell myself that I just needed to be patient.
Yeah.
And it was, you know, the one time after I met my wife and we were going to karaoke and I sang it and I was like, I don't need to be patient anymore, like, because I knew she was the one. And I stopped singing and stuff. But every night I would sing that and you could hear it in my heart, like, you know, just waiting, just trying to be patient for the right one, that it's going to work out, that person who I love is there and waiting, and just like telling myself to calm the F down, like communicating with myself through the song. But, you know, when I met my wife, you know, she was that patience that I was waiting for, you know, so it got better. And I switched to Meatloaf and went to Crying Out Loud. I know I love you.
Yeah. And that's a great anecdote. And, you know, thanks for sharing it with the viewers first. And the second thing is, you know, a great illustration of the healing power of music. Like, I always feel that music is more than the sum of its parts. And just one other quick shout out for Across the Universe. It's not just one favorite song. There's many great ones, but I at least got to mention the I Want to Hold Your Hand. Remember, the girl sings it about the other girl, and it's sort of like a slow motion version. Like, it's really slowed down. An extremely powerful song. And viewers, if you haven't seen Across the Universe, listen to Travis. Drop everything and check it out. We promise you're going to love it.
You absolutely should. Like, it is one of the best musical, and just like love of, it's such a encapsulating of the time, about what the Beatles were about, and really making some of those songs like have that extra weight to them, right? They're not just songs. Right. And even the silly ones fit, right? Because I'm sure we've seen Yellow
and they're
Submarine.
Sort of, like you said, reimagined. It's, you know, because some of the songs, let's be honest, they don't all date very well, but the way that they redid them is like, wow, this is totally, you know, modern. And that was, like I say, 2007. So, you know, pretty relevant to today even.
So good. Great actors too. Great actors.
Yeah, all the parts are just a treasure. And a quick mention, when we make these lists, especially about music, it doesn't mean that 11 is better than 10, or it's not a ranking by how good the songs are or the material. This is just, they're just collected, you know, so, right.
Tim's like, clearly I'm hearing you talk about it. It should be clearly closer to number one. I get it.
right. Well, and sometimes people say stuff like that, like, how could you put that at number 11? Across the Universe is the best. Well, you might be right, but we just organize them into 11 for ease of talking about them.
Right. I would put them closer to number one, guys. Just
gotcha. Well, when you see the number one, you might disagree, because I got one of your favorites close to the top.
Right.
The next one I got for you, and this is veering back around toward what you and I would call a classic Broadway musical. And I know we were talking backstage, and Travis and I are both Broadway fans, which is maybe would surprise some people out there. And we both come by it honestly. We're both artistic types and we're both creators. But, you know, not everybody relates to Broadway musicals. And I understand why. The material is not always necessarily for everybody. But there was a more recent one where they reimagined traditional material in a way that was modern, compelling, and relevant to today. Of course, I'm talking about 2015. This is Hamilton. What's your thoughts on Hamilton?
Oh, Hamilton is me and my wife love Hamilton. It is probably our favorite musical. We saw it actually in Orlando. We paid the crazy price to see it in Orlando, which is crazy. And if you haven't seen it live, you should, but you're also going to be disappointed, because that show is so fast because of the beats and the way they do it.
The pacing.
And let's be honest, like, Tim, like, I write like I'm running out of time. Like, that's what my thing. So those are my mottos. Like, I really believe that the motto of my writing life is writing my way out. Like, because I come, you know, I've shared in a lot of my podcasts that I come from a broken home, drug and alcohol family. Like, I shouldn't be able to achieve these things. Like, if on paper, you wouldn't have done it, but I've written my way out my whole life. like just writing stuff. In fact, the way I got through English and grammar and stuff in school, I was never good at grammar. Anybody who follows me on Facebook can tell I'm not great at grammar. I need my wife to edit me. The way I did it was I would write more than the other person. So if I had a paragraph due, I'd give you a page and a half. And I would then talk to the teacher and be like, hey, I did more work than him. Like, consistently, if you cut all letters, you know, and I would just convince them over and over again.
Valid point.
Probably some teacher should have been like, hey, no, I care about the where's and where's and there, and there, or which is which.
Well, and one thing I like to say about creative projects, and it's especially true in Hamilton, the rules are made to be broken.
Right.
You know, first, let's touch on, you got, I hope I'm saying his name correctly, Lin-Manuel Miranda.
Correct. Yep.
Mm-hmm. A genius. If you would have said, hey, I got this idea, I'm adapting this historical novel into a hip hop musical, you say that it doesn't even make any sense. And he came out with a creation that was so brilliant and so inventive that even people who were haters had to go, holy crap, this is good.
Yeah, it is wild. It is a wild show in every aspect of it. It is just the way they did it. And even like, you know, because I study, like Hamilton for me is not just like the musical, like I studied it a lot. Even some of the throwbacks to like modern rap that are in there are like precise and like throwing into old school rap and doing all those things, which are great. And I think it's the best one that's been done since Moulin Rouge, because Moulin Rouge is the first one that kind of turned your head, right? Moulin Rouge was like, you can't do that. You can't like put random songs together and make a musical. You can't do that. Well, it happens the same way.
One of the things that I like about him, he has sort of this, what I call an inventive rhyming pattern. Like some of the words that he strings together in these rhymes, you go, how did he come up with that? Like it certainly defies conventional poetry, and it even defies conventional rap, right? Like it's not really either one. It's kind of a new thing.
Yeah. And then in the middle, there's like two or three ballads to remind you this is theater. Right. Like so it's rap crazy them thing. And then just the decisions that they're making, like of having showing the parallels between the characters in the first act and the second act, right? Because they replay the character, right? You've got Lafayette, who then becomes Thomas Jefferson, like playing those, but looking at the parallels of stories of who they're playing and how they're connected, it's still the same story. And it's wild, man. It's wild.
And I am always a sucker for movies and TV shows and all kinds of media that portrays elements of history that otherwise I might not have been too close to. And that's definitely one. And the same can be said for our number 9. Now, this was a Broadway musical and a movie, which I love both. For the purposes of our talk, I'm going to talk a little bit about the movie, but I'm interested to hear your thoughts. This is 1978 was the movie. It's Grease. Were you a fan of that one?
Well, I mean, I played Kinnicky in Grease once. So, you know.
Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me?
There's nothing like a hickey from Kinnicky. No.
That's amazing.
I did. And there's nothing like a hickey from Kinnicky. No, I love Grease. I love, Grease is so great because the things they got away with saying in 1978, right?
Yeah. You know, it's kind of dirty, right?
Right, the chicks will cream, like, whoa, like, right. What do you say? I mean, like, I remember, like, in theater, like, we had to change the words, and the teacher had to explain why we're changing the words because
Isn't Grease Lightning a real pussy wagon?
Right, it's a real pussy wagon. Right. I hold on. What was it? Hold on, because it was in high school. It's a real. I don't remember. I don't remember what we said. I think Shaggin' Wagon, I think maybe. Because it was Austin Powers Day, so you could get away with it. Because that's when I was in school. But Real Pussy Wagon. But like all these things, like Grease was such a crazy phenomenon, you know. And the movie, you know, is so iconic. And the things that they're dealing with, like that would never make the air, like, and the fact that it's still around today, because that's everything about that is cancel culture, right? Like when you talk about the cancel, like everything that John Travolta does in that, but for some reason that movie gets untouched, right? We're changing right. books, but like, not to get into that stuff, but that, that music, for some reason we forgive it. And everybody has an arc, which is, was unheard of really at that time. You know, those old musicals really had the lead and the secondary lead were the only people who completed their arc. Everybody else has just kind of sit around. Maybe Sound of Music was a little different because the kids all had an arc, but most of those old school musicals, one or two leads got their story and that's it. All the other
great
characters
point.
Don't matter.
Yeah, it was a true ensemble. And and you mentioned, and man, it's right on the money, what would be considered very edgy content.
Right.
You know, it had some sexuality. The guys were overly aggressive. Right. A couple of the girls were what you and I would call easy, right? And
right.
There was a whole thing with that. And one thing I want to quick mention too, I had a crush on Olivia Newton-John that exists to today. And I just thought she was awesome. And what a great singer and what a terrific human being. Just a terrific job by her all the way around.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it was, she really like was a class act in everything she did. And she never complained, never did. She always did her job. You know, she really like everything she brought so much to it to do the role. But yeah, I could
yeah, and it's funny when you think of Sandy, boy, you just think of Olivia Newton-John, and here it
right,
is,
yeah.
You know, 50 years later, and it's still just as memorable.
Right. Yeah.
By the way, the whole lineup of songs, they're all terrific. I love Grease Lightning. I was in a band. We played a rendition, like a metal version of Grease Lightning, which lends itself to a hard rock song very well.
Yeah.
And also, I'm a fan of Stockard Channing's There Are Worse Things I Could Do, which is like a torch ballad. But boy, she just belted it out. She can really sing. Terrific, terrific songs in that. And easily could be described as a movie that influenced pop culture.
Absolutely. I definitely think it did. I think it also, like, I think theater kids have known the edge from it for a long time. And I think they've always looked into it and been like, okay, this is that. But what I like about it too, is that the women characters are so strong, which is rare, especially in 1978, the women characters having such a big throwback to everything and putting these guys in their place, which is the way life really is. Let's be
right.
Honest. Yeah. We fall in love with these when we're all tough. The minute we get home, like we're all submissive. Like don't lie, don't pretend otherwise, because you know that's what love is. Love makes you soft.
Yep. Well, and you know, for our next one, I wanted to jump back. We both talked about the Beatles, and I'm a huge Beatles fan, as most people are. And I felt like, even though not a true musical, you know, we want to talk about things that influenced pop culture. And back in 1964, nobody was doing this, and the Beatles released sort of a rock biopic zany adventure. It was called A Hard Day's Night, and it featured a lot of their best songs and went on to influence many things that came after, like things like the Monkees and you know, the Partridge Family and all the other stuff that
even
came
heavy
afterward.
Metal.
Right. Yeah, I would buy that.
Yeah, I would even throw heavy metal in that like group. This little like putting an album kind of together like with song is wild. Never heard of it. And that song, I think, only gets the play that it gets because of that. Because it's not one of their better songs, but Hard Day's Night is, if you're playing a Beatles melody, you have to put it on there. Like, it's one of those things. Even though, like, I mean, Across the Universe didn't use it. You know?
Yeah, right. And I figured that was probably intentional because it would be too much of a, because when you think of A Hard Day's Night, let's be honest, you probably don't even think of the music. What you think is the Beatles running around acting kind of kooky, right? It was almost sort of like a comedy. It was like a little bit of everything thrown in. And for that reason, I wanted to link these two together. And this is why I have for number seven. This was the first what they call a rock opera. That's, of course, 1975. This was by The Who. It's their rock opera, Tommy. I remember the first time I saw that, my mind was blown. It was so edgy and so weird. And there was nothing like it.
I do. I also remember that. So I saw that weekend, I saw The Doors, the Doors musical, like not music, the biopic. Biopic of the Doors.
Good honorable mention. Good honorable mention for
and
the
I was way too young to understand that. What the door? But then my dad put on because my dad loved the Doors. He then put on the Who, like right after. And I remember seeing Pinball Wizard and like me as a kid going, oh, this one's for me, Dad, right? Like this is gonna be a nice feel good movie,
right?
Right, because it opens up with Pinball. I was like, oh, but he's definitely what's going, Dad? Like, I
what is going on?
Like, what is going on here?
There's a lot of darkness in Tommy. It isn't necessarily a feel good kind of hit. He's deaf, dumb, and blind, and there's a sadistic uncle that molests him, and there's a lot of weird stuff. And I guess you could make a point that the ending of it is like a triumph. You know, he overcomes his adversity, but he has to sit through quite a bit to get there. And it's admittedly, Tommy's not for everybody.
I feel it's a spiritual successor to like Clockwork Orange.
Oh yeah.
Because like, it brings those same feels of uncomfortableness that you got from Clockwork Orange that you enjoyed, but then adding the Who music into it just brings this crazy thing. And I'm a huge Roger Daltrey fan. Love Roger Daltrey.
Yeah. And got to give a shout out here to Elton John for he was the Pinball Wizard.
Right, sure, yeah.
And, you know, I'm a little older, right? So I can remember the pizza place down the street, being a pinball king was one of the things that you did. And I can remember we'd go down there and we'd have our quarters stacked on the machine and we'd want to play against the older kids who were, you know, older kids then, they were 15, 16. Right. And I can remember, here's a memory for you. They rolled in the new machines. In those days, pizza places would lease these machines for a small monthly fee. And then when the new machines came in, I can remember we all turned around and we went, Space Invaders? What's that? Because, of course, video games were, I'd never even seen one. And, of course, we all know what happened with video games. We'll save that for another show. But, you know, Pinball Wizard.
I had that, too. I mean, probably just because I lived in New Hampshire, so we just didn't evolve as fast.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so even me growing up, you know, I'm a little younger than you. I had a pinball machine in my stuff, and I remember it was crazy, but it turned me on to so many things. Like, they got the Doctor Who written. I was like, what's Doctor Who? It on PBS, watch Doctor Who. Like I remember those pinball machines influencing what I wanted to find on the TV or find a book about, because they always had these magical things and these sound effects. I'm like, what is going on?
Well, you know, you make a good point, because I can remember playing pinball was cool. And at the time, it was almost considered to be sort of maybe not quite gambling, but there was something sort of juvenile delinquent-ish about playing pinball. And it wasn't until Tommy came out, I was like, oh, the Pinball Wizard. It like exemplified what was cool about being a pinball player, and which I think is still cool today. I like to go to those places when they have they call it a retro arcade here in Pennsylvania. And you pay like $20 or $30 and you go in and it's all these old pinball machines and you can just play to your heart's content. I love those places.
Yeah. We actually just had a recent one moved here called Monster Arcade, and it's really cool. It's got a couple of pinball rooms. It's got like old games from the 90s, but then you go all the way to the left side and it's all games imported from Japan.
Oh,
like,
wow.
So you don't even know how to play. Like, so it's wild. It's this wild place where it really takes you through the time. Here's your pinballs. Here's your stuff. And it goes to the stuff and it has almost everything. It's wild.
I would love that. I'll check that out if I come up there.
Next time you come, I'll bring you.
I dig that. So we'll circle back to our number six. And this one's a little bit what some people would call a classic Broadway show. And I'm also going to talk about the movie, which surprisingly I loved. I'm talking about 2008's Mamma Mia. It's one of those things where I'm almost ashamed to admit it, because it certainly wouldn't be considered very masculine, I guess. And, you know, I like to fashion myself as this metalhead, right? But I can tell you, when I sat through Mamma Mia and I watched both of them, I was just in hypnotized by how good it was. And of course, for viewers that don't know, it reimagines the classic songs of a 70s Swedish rock act called ABBA.
So here's I hate ABBA. I hate ABBA with all my being. I even hate Mamma Mia, which I think I may have told you, but my wife and daughter love it. Like, it really resonates with them. I've seen it live. I've seen it played live. And I do love, even though like you can always appreciate something even if you don't like the music. So
yeah,
the
very
album
much.
music really grates on me. But the story is so interesting, and
It's a great
the
story.
people who they show, and the fact that, because I've watched Mamma Mia 1 and 2, the fact that the second one is really just as good as the first one,
It
like
is.
musically and everything. And they're working on a third, from what I understand. Like, it's wild, and like putting all these stories together with the three, the trying to figure out who the dad is, all this stuff. It's bewildering. Like, you cannot help but respect everything it is. And even the actors in there, like, some of them aren't the greatest singers, but because of what they're singing, you know,
They
they
sell
make
it.
sure the females are great, but the males aren't as great. It adds that extra realism to a musical, like, which is wild.
Well,
So
and
yeah.
from a creative standpoint, I'll tell you what I thought was cool. These songs are not written as a soundtrack. None of them go together. And yet somehow they took it and they wove a movie together out of these very disparate songs. And again, it's one of those things where this is just between us, right? Like, who sits down at a pitch meeting and says, hey, I got this idea. We're going to create this stage musical or movie, either one, and it's going to be based on songs from ABBA. Like, wait, what? Like, they had to say, look, are you on drugs? Because they were well past their prime. They're certainly not. And by the way, don't hear that I'm disparaging ABBA. I don't mean that. I think they're great.
Please disparage ABBA. Like,
but look,
I told you,
they
I
weren't
don't
exactly
like them.
they weren't exactly superstars. We're not talking about the Beatles, the Who. Like, you get why the other ones would have got their own production, but I'm sure everybody had to be like, wait, what? ABBA? Really?
Yeah, like, I mean, if I was going to pick a music, if you were going to pick someone, you'd want to pick like Heart, right? Or something with little stuff, you know, something with a little more edge to it, a little bit more classic stuff, you know.
Maybe a little more bombastic, you know.
Yeah.
And
what I like about what ABBA is interesting too is, even like, not only did they string it together, there is very little dialogue that pushes it together.
Right.
It's not like it's dialogue that's going to carry the song. It's not like the songs, they found a way to make ABBA flow, which is fascinating. And it fascinates my wife and my daughter.
And definitely a huge influence on culture too. Like, I'm always amazed by how popular it is, and not just the stage show, but the movie too. And even, of course, it was referenced in 30 Rock, if you're a fan of the TV show.
Yeah. I mean, you play Mamma Mia at a wedding, you're going to get all the girls jumping on.
Yeah. And, you know, I got to mention, in case she's watching too, my love of theater and my love of Broadway musicals. Of course, I love music in all its forms anyway, but specifically Broadway, I get from my daughter, Sarah, who has dragged me to Broadway musicals ever since she was 6 years old. And we've seen a whole bunch of them, and some of them even multiple times. And
what was your daughter in plays?
Oh, yeah. All the time. She's a singer.
For me, like, I gotta, this is kind of a side, but I think it's important. Like, so I was a theater kid and I had no problem getting parts. And then watching, like, seeing it from the other perspective, from a female perspective, like, there is so many more females in theater than men. Like, how competitive it is, and how it broke my heart. Cause I'm just like, oh, just do it. You'll get a part. Like, cause I didn't realize that at the time growing up, there was only 8 other guys. So the odds of getting a part are pretty freaking high, right?
Well, and I will mention, and boy, I hope it's okay to say this, I hope it comes out the right way. You know, I wasn't really exposed to musical theater too much till I was in college, but I was always friends with the theater gang, not just the singers, but the musicians and also the stage hands and stuff. And there was a, you know, there was always kind of a stigma, hey, well, this is where the gay kids are, right?
Sure.
And that was kind of the first time where I was like, oh, it's okay to hang out with the gay kids. They're kind of cool. Right. And if it wouldn't have been for that experience, maybe I never would have seen that side, maybe. I don't know. I hope I didn't say that the wrong way, but.
No. Absolutely. I think it's.
It's not exactly a shocker that Broadway musicals are full of gay kids. I know that's not the amazing part. But, you know, like I say, I was never exposed to that element.
Yeah, I mean, Rent was a huge influence in my life. Like, most of the things that I do, Rent is a huge influence. So for that was really crazy. And, like, even being in theater kids, though, like, I was a cool kid. Like, I played football and I was in theater. So I was kind of this weird guy who could kind of go between the tribes. But I still remember every time a kid would come out, like, and say, hey, I'm gay, I'd still be like, what?
Yeah.
And I was like, but why are you telling me? I'm a football player. Like, but you also love Rent, so you're clearly okay with, like,
right.
Like, I was like, oh yeah. Like, but I remember, like, because we still had this stigma against it, even though you could see the world was changing, like in the 90s when I was doing it. The times were changing, but yeah. I was still in shock every single time a friend of mine, I was like, but are you sure? Like, yeah, okay. All right, I guess you're gay. All right, what does that mean?
Like, it was the same for me. I was the bassist, and I was in a couple of these productions. And like I say, I'm mostly known as this rock and metal guy, but right. I'll just share something quick. You might think it's cool. And this is when I was, I guess I must have been 16 years old. I just moved to a new city, and there was this girl I liked. Her name was Tracy. And right. she came up to me one day after school, and she said, hey, I heard that you're a bassist. And I was like, yeah, you know, I play and blah, blah, blah. And I already had a crush on her. She's right. like, well, we do this. It's a church production of a stage show called Godspell.
Yeah.
You're familiar with it? And she said, are you familiar?
I was with Judas.
It? Oh, no kidding. Wow. Yeah. So it's got to tie into your book.
Yeah. My love of Jews is definitely from Jesus Christ Superstar and Godspell. But
continue, I love that one too. Yeah. So and of course I said, well, of course, and I had no idea what it was. And she said, well, okay, great. I have the sheet music for it. Do you read sheet music? Yeah, I sure do, because I took lessons and stuff. Right. And I'm not very handy with sheet music, right? So she gives me the sheet music, and I go home and I'm like, dum dum, okay, C, D minor, dum dum, and I'm learning it really slowly.
Right.
And I had an excuse. I called her up. I was like, hey, Tracy, by any chance, do you have a recording of last night's show? She said, I do. I have it on cassette. Hey, can I swing by your house and get it? I go, I pick up the tape. I come home, put the headphones on. Ding, ding, dee, 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 ding. And the next night I knew the whole thing, because I can learn by ear pretty fast. But anyway, I ended up dating her. So my love of Godspell is firmly ingrained into my soul.
Yeah. And Godspell is such a tough one. It's such a, because it's unlike Jesus Christ Superstar, was kind of like a, we're going to tell you the story, like, but we're going to make it cool. And we're going to make it fit. Like, it's the book of Matthew. Like Godspell is literally the book of Matthew, like verbatim through the stuff and trying to fit and doing the parable. Like, you can know, if you know Godspell, you can literally share 5 to 6 parables to people.
right. Exactly. And I was, you know, not for nothing, I think the songwriting on both of those two productions is terrific.
I wish we lived closer, because I'd give you, I actually have that DVD. I don't know how to stream it and cut. I would give it to you so you can add it to this.
Oh, man, I'd love that. And, you know, we've been lucky enough to be talking about some of the classic Broadway stuff.
Yeah.
This one, again, was a Broadway and a movie. And sometimes, especially for viewers, hey, if you like both, if you like the movie better, please let us know. There's nothing wrong if you like the movie better. And this one was a fairly traditional translation. In this case, the movie was in 2007. This is Hairspray. What'd you think of that one?
So I'm not a huge fan of Hairspray for the music part, but the John Waters influence of it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I'm all about, like, him taking that movie and making that, because I've seen the musical and I've seen the play, him making it a John Waters film, because he has a style and unique thing, but keeping the message of what Hairspray is all about,
right.
which aligns with his message, sure, but like,
and hold on, let me pin you down. So to your mind, what is the message of Hairspray?
It's about acceptance, really. Yeah. Like,
it's okay to be different.
Right. It's okay to be different. Okay to be accepted. Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
That's what I would have said too. And
you know, and even when they tried to redo it with John Travolta a couple of years ago, like I, what was that? What was that? The Live? I don't remember. I remember John Travolta played the mom.
Yeah. Yeah. He plays the mother.
Is that in 2007 or is that?
Yep. That's the 2007 one. And by the way, I thought he was great. He was great in it. I thought it was certainly weird looking, you know, but he sold it.
Yeah, I think it's great. I think it's such an important piece too, for heavyset women to get a part in a prominent part and an important part, because, you know, anybody who's ever gone to church in any band, there is beautiful heavyset women bolting out sounds that you will never hear, and they don't get the limelight. They get it in church, but they never get it in a theater production. But they've got Hairspray, And they can do it, you know?
Yeah, and you bring up a good point, and you know, I hope it's okay to mention this too. You and I sort of touched on it. You know,
yeah.
we're both white fellas, so sometimes we have a maybe not as broad of a perspective as we might all want to have. And I can tell you, as a musician, what I learned from watching, and now I'm referring to bass players. So if there's any sure. bass players out there that would like to chime in and say something different, you're welcome to. But when you would go into the gig, and let's say that we're the ones that go on at 8 o'clock and the next act goes on at 10 o'clock, and mm-hmm. I look around and let's say he's a bass player of color, I knew he's about to give a show, because that is right. about the only guy that could show me up. And there's something about, I don't know what it is, but you know, the bass players of these rhythm and blues acts,
sure.
they're incredible. They're incredible, right?
And I mean, think of a famous white saxophonist. There isn't.
right. Yeah. And, you know, I don't know what the ingredient is, because it certainly, in my opinion, it isn't classical training. It isn't. I mean, maybe it's just experience, and maybe maybe they have a broader experience than we had ourselves, potentially. Because, you know, I was.
Well, they have deeper voices than us, so I think they speak more bass than a white guy.
Yeah, that's probably true. But the way it ties into what you were saying, you talked about overweight. I don't know, is that the right way to say it?
Yeah, I think overweight is good. Yeah. You know, so overweight is what it is. We're not saying that it's bad.
Where I'm headed, bear with me. I'm headed toward that it's good. But you know, when you go in and you see this girl, you know you're about to see somebody sing their ass off. Right. And you know, you're in for a treat. And I think that's something that Hairspray did. That when you talk about had a very diverse cast, right? And a lot of people that really shone in their roles. And I put it on the list primarily because I genuinely love the songs.
Yeah, and I feel that, you know, Hair did something similar, but I feel that Hairspray like really got down to the message, right?
Right.
Hair is a bunch of songs. We're being naked to shock people. Hairspray is just like, no, we've got massive talent, we've got massive diversity. We can sing, and like you said, sing, but they can also dance their ass off. But being Hairspray, you got to know how to dance. You've got to be, plus size and know how to dance. Like really, really, really know how to dance. It's amazing. The production to put into Hairspray.
Well, and since you mentioned it, we at least got to give an honorable mention to Hair, because again, talking about the influence on pop culture,
yeah.
that was the counterculture of 68 right there, right. You know, anti-war, pro marijuana, burn your draft card, burn your bra. Sure. And, you know, for the time that was very, very edgy, not to mention that there was a lot of sexuality sure. in it, which, while that might not be as shocking today, man, in the early 70s, people are like, what are you doing?
And it gave us Meatloaf, which for me is very important.
Yeah, I love Meatloaf. Some of the best album covers, you know, we talk about him on our other show.
Better to Hell.
Yeah, one of the classics.
100%. 100%. Yeah,
I got to ask you, Travis, because this next one's going to be controversial. And if my daughter was here, the first words out of her mouth would be, that is not a musical. And she's technically correct, the best kind of correct. But I'll tell you why I put it on the list. Because one of the rules is at least three songs. And this one had, as I recall, I think 15, 16 songs. Mm-hmm. Definitely initiated a wave of a style of music, which was not that popular until this movie. And I am talking about, this is 1977's Saturday Night Fever, which ushered in the disco movement, which was incredibly popular in the late 70s. First of all, what do you think of this pick?
Well, first, I feel I'm the best person to speak on this subject. My last name being Gibb.
You're an honorary BG.
Right. So if anyone's going to speak on the importance of disco in the 70s, I believe someone with the last name Gibb should be top on that list.
As noted.
So, of course. I mean, not only did that make John Travolta, like all John Travolta, like... He was great in Grease. He's okay in Hairspray. He's great in Pulp Fiction. But Saturday, that's his legacy.
Right.
That's his legacy.
Agreed.
When they play that, he's died. That's the clip they're gonna play. They're not gonna play any of these other iconic. And I love all those iconic roles. You know, you give me a Face Off John Travolta. You give me a Punisher Melodrama. You give me a Pulp Fiction, Jules, like, love it. But Saturday Fever, it John Travolta, like, and he came off of Welcome Back, Kotter to do that, like, and going, like, this is cool. Like, I am defining cool. This kind of dance, this kind of music is what's cool, and you need to get out there and do it. And it proved that it worked. Like, it like, people flooded to dance.
It's easy to forget now, but when disco music came out, and I'm referring specifically to, it was the soundtrack album for Saturday Night Fever. It sold just an impossible number of copies, and Disco Fever swept the nation. People coast to coast were going to discos. They were dancing. It became a thing. And of course, it became such a big thing that people started pushing back on it almost right away, like all popular things.
Sure. But I mean, it changed. There was a whole separate like style of thing. And you can't, like, disco, like, people like to go, well, disco was such a small, because it's such a small time frame that it happened. And the only music you can really compare it to is, like, grunge, right? Because grunge only had a small amount of time, about the same as stuff.
Right, but a good metaphor here. Keep going. Yeah, I can agree with
that. Yeah, but one of them, grunge, literally just got replaced and, like, molded into other music and, like, lost it. Disco had clubs dedicated to it. There was no clubs dedicated to grunge. There wasn't grunge clubs, right?
Right.
There was a player that played grunge on Friday nights, and every other night of the week they played the regular rock or heavy metal, whatever. But disco took time and still has places. There are still disco places in not everywhere, but if you go to any major city like a Miami or New York or California, like you'll find a disco themed stuff, even if it's nostalgic themed, like kind of ironic themed, like you'll find that grunge didn't have that impact, but the same amount of energy and time. And there is people who keep saying it's going to come back. I think we have a better chance of seeing disco come back than grunge.
Oh yeah. Listen, I agree with you 100%. And, you know, I mentioned, occasionally I sit in with bands and things, and it's one of the things we often do is reworkings of classic disco songs. Right. And we do stuff like Disco Inferno was one of the last ones, which it's great stuff. And I think specifically the Bee Gees, the Brothers Gibb,
right?
The songwriters, their skills were, like, I guess what I'm saying is it's easy to make fun of disco like it was a trend, but what got it there was the skills of these songwriters, in particular, the Brothers Gibb, the Bee Gees.
Have you ever heard of my stories of being named Travis Gibb, like my issues with it?
I don't think so.
I'll go into it really quick. So I am 44 years old. Barry Gibb has a son named Travis Gibb, also 44 years old. We both, all Gibbs have this. Like, if you look at any of the Bee Gees,
a philtrum,
they have that missing thing on their mustache. So my whole life, since I've moved to Florida, people have always asked me if I'm related to Barry Gibb's son. Because we're the same age, we're the same town. Like, when you do a Google search, you know that the Gibbs are in Florida.
No kidding.
Florida, they're in Miami. Like, I get messages all the time, and, like, we're the same age. I even was asked, there's a show that just aired last season, like, who am I related to? It's a show about guessing what famous relative. I got invites as Travis Gibb to be on that show, and I was like, I'm not that Gibb. Like, I'm not related. In fact, my mother-in-law claims that I'm not related at all. She did the ancestry, she did all that. I was like, no, we both have the same last name. We are related somewhere. You just can't find it. Like, literally, we have to be somewhere.
Well, you definitely have a super strong creative thread in your spirit. Are you a musician? I forget if we ever talked about this.
I'm not. Did singing and stuff. And I can play piano if I had cheap music.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah, but it would be fair to say that you're a super creative guy. And
yeah.
For better or for worse, it's in you.
Yeah, no. So my whole life, I will get it once a year, a message from someone trying to reach Barry Gibb. Hey, your dad really influenced me. Can you have your dad send us a Christmas message song real quick? I was like, that's first off, my dad's dead. And his name was John Gibb, and he lived in New Hampshire. So, like, no, it's not going to work out for you. But yeah, it's a curse.
Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah.
So we're talked about some of the musicals that influenced pop culture, and this next one is a big one. And of course, there was a very successful stage show and also a pretty successful movie. At least my understanding is it's pretty successful. And the original show is from 1961, and the movie was 2021, which shows you some of the longevity of the source material, 60 years between. Of course, I'm talking about West Side Story, the Sharks and the Jets. What do you got to say about West Side Story?
Well, I was in West Side Story, but I did not play anybody important. But I was a Jet because when you're a
Jet.
Jet through and through.
Exactly.
So I don't have a lot on that. But West Side Story, I mean, it's classic. It's the best. It literally is. I actually haven't seen the newest one. Have you had a chance to the Spielberg one?
I did. I liked it. You know, some people didn't really like it as much. And like I try to focus on the stuff that we really love, as you've noticed. And so when I look at stuff like that, I see the positives, right? Like I thought it was very true to the original source material. I thought the girl that was Maria, she was dynamite, I thought. I thought the singing was terrific. I didn't have any beef with it. So I guess the one thing that I guess the one thing that I would add is Steven Spielberg, he's a little bit of a blockbuster guy. It might have been better to go with a little bit more intimate style director, a little closer, maybe character studies. But you know, it's nitpicking. I love West Side Story. There wasn't my recommendation is people, if you haven't seen it, go check it out. If you're lucky enough to, you know, see the stage show or man, especially one of the original ones, you're in for a treat. But yeah, I would say that, you know, the West Side Story is probably the, you know, the OG of the you know, Broadway musicals and the first one to bring, you know, the sort of the Romeo and Juliet story. And I thought the movie was great. I would definitely recommend it.
And I think it's a man's. I don't think a man can go. A man who even hates musicals can go to West Side Story and go. That it's manly. Like you feel it. You feel the stuff and the love for that musical in such a speaking of the Spanish culture.
And by the way, I thought that was well done in the movie too. And it was they did a good job of selling the differences between the two cultures, and you know, it was something they had to overcome. And it's in my opinion, it was more interesting in West Side Story than it is in Romeo and Juliet. If you think about Romeo and Juliet, the two families are really not that different. So good job on that one. Now, Travis, we're going to move into number two, and this was your pick, and I think it's a great one. I probably wouldn't have chosen this. And maybe people will object because, again, hey, not necessarily a Broadway production, but at least three songs. And what kind of impact did this one have on pop culture? I am talking about Labyrinth.
I don't think you can make this list without a Labyrinth in it. If you're trying to make a list, because Labyrinth,
What a
first
classic.
off, you have David Bowie. Like, you have Jennifer Connelly, who is still doing movies today and still looks like she did like it back
I
then.
love her.
It's
I
crazy,
love her.
right?
Yeah. Well, it appeals to a broad range of people, right? It's a fantasy story. You're going to get the Lord of the Rings people. You're going to get the magic people. You're going to get the musical people.
The Muppets people.
Yeah, the Muppets people. That's its own thing right there. And by the way, the Muppet movie was also in contention for the list. I'm a big sucker for Rainbow Connection. I think their songs are great.
absolutely. But I think Labyrinth did things with puppets. Like Labyrinth was a statement, I think, to for Jim Henson to go, we can do amazing things with puppets. And it led into The Dark Crystal and some of the things that were very influential in the time, because you could show like the range, because all we saw prior to that was Sesame Street and the Muppets, and they were great. They were great, but they weren't changing things. And that's really, I think Labyrinth is what kept Jim Henson Studios on the map.
Yeah, you're
Right?
probably
It
right.
kept them doing these amazing things later in their career. And David Bowie is such a great pick for that. For that in that culture, he fit in. He's wild looking. A lot of people make fun of his crotch, but that's all right. That's all right. Those songs, those David Bowie songs, and that are on par with any David Bowie song.
They're well produced too. It's, you know, they're like set pieces and there's lots of action and dancing and stuff like that. So it is definitely, hey, this is my opinion, viewers. If you want to chime in and say something, let us know. But I would say include it. You know, it's definitely musical numbers, definitely ensemble pieces. And did Labyrinth have an impact on pop culture? Of course.
Yeah. I mean, especially geek culture, you go to any convention and you'll see Labyrinth material to buy till this day. And they've never made a sequel. They've never done anything else with it. There is a comic book, believe it or not. There is a comic book.
Oh, is there?
That goes through. It's like a manga that goes over the son, Dylan, I think was his name. It goes over him when he gets older and the goblins come to him because Jareth has died.
Wow.
And they're like, you're the Goblin King. Like, you were chosen. And like,
that does sound cool. That does sound
like, come back. And like, he's like, what are you talking about? Because, you know, he was a baby.
Well, and you know, Travis, it's a great pick. And that's one of the things that I love the most about these shows. And I'm always fond of saying there really aren't any wrong answers. And almost always the guest comes up with one that's so good. I go, man, how did I not remember that? You know what I mean? And that's definitely the case with Labyrinth. And I will tell the audience who got bumped for Labyrinth. I had the Blues Brothers in that slot.
Yeah.
Now, again, not really a musical, right? But many songs.
Pop culture.
Yeah, right. Pop culture. People forget now that Blues Brothers had a big splash when it came out.
And I would argue that every year since Blues Brothers, there is a reference to Blues Brothers in a movie.
Yeah, yeah. And
there's always Blues Brothers reference, you know.
We kind of forget these days. And of course, we're all a little older and wiser, but at the time, John Belushi and Dan Aykroyd were the superstars of cinema. And for a brief portion, they could do no wrong. And, you know, other than 1941, we'll save that for another list. But, you know, Animal House and, Blues Brothers was the one that it put them firmly on the cultural map.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And even Blues Brothers 2000, you know, with John Goodman, really did a lot of beautiful things, you know, didn't try to jump. I remember specifically interviews going, you can't be Belushi. Like, no one's Belushi but Belushi. And I believe that no one could get away with the things, you know, him and Chris Farley.
Yeah.
Their characters are so far out that there's no one like that. You can't just go, I'm going to pretend to be that. No, you're faking it. Like, you have to have this screw loose in your mind. It's why Bill Murray works. Like, there's something wrong with Bill Murray that makes you love him. Like, and it's great. Just same thing with Jim Carrey. Like, there's something wrong with all these people on a mental level that we love you and please keep doing what you do.
So many great songs. Just a quick shout out on that one. It was, R-E-S-P-E-C-T, isn't that in that movie?
Yeah.
I think it's Aretha Franklin, maybe?
Yeah.
Viewers, that's if I get it wrong, always let me know in the comments. I think, just a show-stopping performance and just awesome set pieces. Yeah.
Got to give some honorable mentions out.
Yeah, man, let's toss them out.
We've got Purple Rain.
Purple Rain. Yeah, Prince fans, you're going to have to take me to court because, you know, we only really had room for 11, but Purple Rain, a huge impact on pop culture.
I think Rent was a miss on the list. You know, Rent was a good one, you're making a list here. What else?
I'm personally a huge Phantom of the Opera fan.
Phantom of the Opera, Phantom of the Opera, Les Mis. I think the reason why those don't make the list, though, is because the musicals always outshine the TV interaction. I think the ones that you picked, there are musical. Hairspray, the musical, is just as good as Hairspray the TV. And there's people who love that, where I don't think Rent, Phantom of the Opera, or Les Mis, the TV, the adaption fits, you know.
Yeah,
even Sweeney Todd's really good, but again,
Sweeney Todd was on the original list too. That's one. And by the way, he had a movie too, I think. Johnny Depp
Tim Burton
was in there.
Tim Burton did Sweeney Todd. I put you never haven't seen it, but Repo the Genetic Opera is really good.
I heard of it. Unfortunately, I hadn't seen that one.
Happy, really recommend checking that out. I think that's a big one. For less, I'm trying to think of one else. Purple Rain was really the one that I was like, that's one that's got to get an honorable mention because I think we'll get shot. I think people will come after us because that movie is so
For sure.
iconic
Yeah.
to certain people in the world. Like,
Even the
you
movie
can't.
poster, it's got a famous movie poster with Prince and the motorcycle. It's still parodied to this day.
And you put A Star Is Born on that and 8 Mile. Those are two that I think are both good mentions.
I thought 8 Mile was relevant because of its influence for that culture. And
yeah, absolutely.
And that was my first, not my first exposure, but I guess you'd say your first mainstream exposure. And what was the other one you said?
Star Is Born.
Oh yeah, Star Is Born, because I wanted to mention both are really terrific. Of course, Judy Garland in one. And I had never really been a Lady Gaga fan. It's Bradley Cooper, right? In the new movie.
Bradley Cooper, yeah.
And they had that song, Shallows.
Yeah.
And man, I loved that song. And I had it mentioned for the list.
Yeah, I hadn't seen that movie. And that's one of the reasons why it wasn't on the list. But you can't acknowledge the cultural impact of that song. I mean, that song.
And, they
again,
played it at the
karaoke
Oscars.
Bars right now, it's 8 o'clock at night. Karaoke is starting. And someone in that top 12 list is going to sing that Shallow. They're going to sing it. It's going to be great.
Well, and I mentioned Judy Garland in the past comments. And, for the number one, I wanted to go back to something a little old school. And again, not technically a Broadway musical, but when you talk about the songs and the impact that it had and how they're still being used today, almost 90 years later, number one, The Wizard of Oz.
Yeah.
And I don't know.
I mean,
go ahead.
No, you go.
Well, the first thing is, okay, viewers, I get it that it's not technically a musical, right? So people will definitely take me to task over that. But let's go through a couple of the categories. You got Judy Garland, musical theater all day long. You got Somewhere Over the Rainbow, Ding Dong, The Witch is Dead. Like, it's memorable songs. This thing came out in 1939. And you can still remember every word to those songs. The impact that it had on pop culture, well, of course, you've got to touch on The Wiz, right? Which is sort of the colorful reimagining, and which is great, by the way. I saw that one. And Wicked.
Yeah.
So very long legs as a cultural property. So that's how I determined its spot. And I'm not just saying that because the movie's old. I really do believe that the songs are that great. And I do think that there's a reason why something lasts so long.
Yeah, it's so there's a word for it. It's called perennial sellers. Some things that will outlast everything else. And
yeah.
And that is one of those films. Like, a kid can watch it today and still be mesmerized, even if it doesn't have the graphics or the stuff that it needs to be that today.
Yeah.
And it's amazing. Like, any remake that they attempt to do, and the reason why they haven't attempted a real remake, they've done like spinoffs and stuff like that. The reason why they haven't, they know that there's something classic about it. There's something about Judy Garland, something about the black and white movie filmed properly in black and white and going to color, like, and having those effects, because you had filmmakers at the time who really knew how to make black and white movies, and they didn't know how to make color, so they made it as bright as possible, way brighter than we would ever do if we were making choices now, but they were trying to show off, like, look at all the colors that we can do, and making it bright and beautiful. And I would argue that it is a proper musical because every school has a rendition of it. There's school productions of Wizard of Oz that are played throughout the years. Yes, it's never made it to Broadway per se, but it has been in sub theaters, small theaters, small house press theaters, in kids theaters for years. There's juniors to adults to stuff. Who put on the play of Wizard of Oz and goes through the movie, for sake, on the regular basis. I was also in The Wizard of Oz. What do you think I played?
You're the Cowardly Lion.
Wish I was that good, but I was a freshman, Tim. I don't get you don't get those good parts when you're a freshman. So I was Mayor of Munchkin City.
Oh,
the country of the land of vaults.
Nice, nice. I guess I can imagine it. You know, I guess it probably when you're a freshman, you probably didn't have the beard yet either.
Right, freshman, you just don't get those good parts, you know, in freshman year. But yeah, I was the mayor of Munchkin City.
Ah, nice, nice.
But you know, these are powerful productions. You know, as you know, I did Cthulhu Invades Oz, and to know that these characters don't exist, and when we talk about Oz, I'm going to go into the literature part of something. Oz is the first superheroes, and people don't realize that. It was the first serialized storytelling. So meaning the Tin Man had an arc. He would go and he would appear and you would do team ups with the, like after Wizard of Oz, they had all these books and they would team up and like do two of the Marvel 2-in-1s, like of these characters. They were written like a comic book. They were written and designed, serialized, and nobody had ever done that before. Nobody had cared to do that before. And he did it for a bunch of books, and he, unlike some of the other ones who've done similar stuff, he is the sole author of all those, like all the way to the end. You know, he had his kid came in and read a few at the end, but like the first 76 of them or whatever are all him, and he would just write them, and he didn't even like writing them. Like if you read his stuff, he's like, I didn't even love them, but these kids, they loved him, and they come to his door,
eat it
hey,
up.
Where's the next one? Where's Dorothy? Where are these things? So he kept writing them with these beautiful things, and nobody beats that legacy when it comes to Oz books. If you've only seen The Wizard of Oz or maybe Wicked or maybe one of the many spinoffs, you haven't even touched the surface of the characters that are in this book, you know, from Return to Oz and all these other stuff. I mean, There's so massive amounts of characters. It was so easy when we did that Cthulhu Invades. And think about it, there's like 76 books in the Oz library. Wonderland has 3. And one of them is a poem book, so it's not even a real book. So it's really only 2 books, Alice in Wonderland and Through the Looking Glass. Peter Pan has 1 book, Neverland. It has 1 book and a stage play.
Yeah.
Oz has 57. Like we're going back to Hamilton, right? And Hamilton wrote another 51. And we're talking about the Bedfield Papers, right? Like this guy wrote like he was running out of time to give us this wonderful classic. And then someone took the best parts of that and gave you Wizard of Oz, because I've read The Wizard of Oz. Literally, it is not the same, and it's literally the best version of this. It's taking the love of this and grabbing the things that would resonate to children and giving it to you. Like, I don't think you guys if you don't read the books, you won't understand the gift that he's giving you for Wizard of Oz, like the movie. Yeah. It's a gift, because it's literally the best renditions of those characters. Takes a lot of the fear and makes it such a beautiful story about your family and about, you know, wanting to leave, but knowing that home is so important and knowing the gift inside of you. Like it's a timeless classic that has impacted everyone, because everyone can relate to one of those characters. Whether I'm scared to leave my home, I don't have, I'm a coward, I don't have the heart, I don't feel I'm smart enough to be able to achieve the things I need to achieve, and I don't think I have a good enough heart to be able to be a member of society. And all that is wrong. All that is wrong, and that's culture hitting down on you. I'm going deep here. It's culture good, going man. Down Keep on going. You. And the Wizard of Oz speaks to that into our soul and in a beautiful musical way, saying, you matter so much. And even like taking all that out of equation, take all those things that I just said, even the Wicked Witch has a redeeming arc. She's just trying to avenge her sister.
Right. Like, yeah.
It's
not,
wild.
Not necessarily a villain.
Right. Not necessarily a villain. Like
yeah.
This bee just came and killed my sister and stole her shoes.
Yeah.
Like I'd be mad too.
Well, and man, I think you have provided a terrific and thoughtful capstone to our list. You know, the magic is inside you is really the message for many of these properties. Okay, so in closing, Travis, I just want to say thanks so much for contributing your thoughts to this list. I had a terrific time making it, and there's some great choices on here. I hope the viewers enjoy it, and it's clear that you're very enthusiastic about music and the accompanying songwriting material. Before we go too far, though, I want to ask you about your project that is currently on Kickstarter. And in particular, can you tell us a little bit about your new song?
Yeah. So it's my song, my wife wrote it. So it's an Orange Cone property. My wife wrote it. I have a son who's 4 years old, and all he eats is, you can actually probably hear him in the background a little bit. All he eats is cottage cheese, loves cottage cheese so much. And my wife started singing a song. We make up songs throughout the house on the regular, but normally it's just for the minute, right? Songs for a minute. And most of our songs related to poop, because poop is very funny for four-year-olds.
Sure, right.
But my wife started writing a song about cottage cheese, and it was pretty good.
Yeah, I just wanted to comment, Travis, you know, I'm very critical of songwriting and music production in particular. It's something that we do over here. And I will say that I think your song came out terrific. Viewers, it's well recorded. It's catchy as all get out. And the lyrics are really humorous and very, very memorable. So great job all around.
Yeah. My wife wrote it, you know, and she, you know, before I knew it, I was like, oh, you should write that song down. So she wrote a song down. The next thing I know, I'm going to she's like, it's done. We're going to the studio to record it. Like, what? Yeah, no, we're going to spend some comic money. We're making a comic. We're doing what? She's got art pages. And we got one of these art pages. And it's so tough because children's books don't do well on Kickstarter, which is pretty sad. And you know, because you know how much it costs to produce these things. I mean, this costs a fortune. Like, I'm going to be honest, like, producing a music is not cheap, but, you know, doing that kind of quality, you know, going into the studio and recording and making that stuff. And my wife is not, you know, a seasoned musician. So, you know, they had to do a lot of takes and stuff like that and trying to figure all that out and then making a comic book that fits with that. But we wanted to do something for the kids. It's a sing-along comic. So what it is, a super delish sing-along comic, cottage cheese. And it's a book where you take it and it'll sing the song to you as you're going through the book, which is really, really cute. And the book is about my family. It's about my son and my dog and me and my stepdaughter and my mother-in-law and my 21-year-old daughter. And there's a whole bunch of inside jokes from the comics to stuff and just telling about our life. And it's so beautiful, like having your wife write, do this kid, like, for most people who read this, they're just gonna be like, this is a kid's book. I was like, yeah, but that's my wife showing how much she loves her family. Like, she wrote this beautiful book about how much she loves us all. And well, and giving to my son a book about cottage cheese, you know? And you know me, I swear, Guaranteed to Say Buck is a very dark book about drinking and having enough. Cthulhu Invades is murder all over, dark stuff, you know, going to Judas, demons, you know, and my wife is writing this sweet, beautiful book to give to children. And, you know, we're trying to get it funded and it's struggling a little bit. I'll be honest, we only got like a week left and it's getting a little scary, you know. Normally, you've seen me, I fund in like the second day and I'm not trying to brag or like, it's just so different. It means so much more to our family and to see it because it's a children's book that it gets a little oversight.
Well, and I hope that hopefully we'll get some music lovers that will be watching this little episode tonight.
Yeah.
And I hope that we can drum up some backers for you because, Travis, I think you've done a terrific job of what I call walking the walk. You support the indie community. And look, speaking directly, you've been an influence to me in many ways, as I disclosed earlier.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for what you do. And let's see if we can get this book funded and help people to experience this treasure that he's created. Look, you guys know that I can be tough on music, and I thought you did a great job on the song. And I will put some snippets in here of it in the video if I can get it to fit in. But if not, I'll put the links below, and we'll see what we can do to get this thing across the curb.
I appreciate that, yeah.
Yeah, man. And, you know, I am not too knowledgeable about children's books. I have, you know, thought about that process. But as you mentioned, it can be very challenging and it's not necessarily what you're known for. And who knows, maybe it'll become what you're known for. You know,
yeah, believe it or not, I am actually, somebody else asked me to do a children's book with them. But I would never call it a children's book. It would be an all ages book because apparently that children, because you can't lie. This is not an all ages book. It's a kid's book. It's 100% designed for kids and getting kids to enjoy cottage cheese and stuff. Like, we're not going to mix words just because it'd be better sales algorithms, you know, but I do believe anybody can love the song and can appreciate it. And people may have kids at home that can do it. And we have a couple tiers on there for retail. And we have tiers if you want to donate to a classroom, you know, if you want to pay a little bit to donate to a classroom. We'll go ahead and do that and package it up. And actually, we're going to do special covers for that classroom where they can write their name on the front, which is pretty cool.
That is a great idea. That is a great idea. Well, I'll tell you, Travis, I wish you every success with it. And, you know, it's something that I just a quick reminder that, you know, anytime in the creative process, it's easy for a guy like me to say, but sometimes, you know, we worry about the back end and the sales algorithms and all these other things. And we tend to lose focus on that. You've created something magical, which could potentially live through the ages, and you'll have something that your children are going to be able to listen to and look at when they're grown up and say, man, my dad was, he was an awesome dude. And congratulations to you for achieving that.
Yeah, no, that's, thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah, we're very proud of it. And hopefully we can get a few more backers to get it to where it goes. It's doing great. You know, we got 6 days left, 75 backers. I don't know when this airs, Tim. When do you air this?
Usually, it'll be probably Wednesday night. It'll go up.
Okay. So you got, all right. Yeah. So we'll be in the last few days of it.
But, I'll make sure it gets in time. I'll see if I can get up a day or two early.
Yeah. But we'll be in the last few days of it. But you know, give it a shot. You know, give it a shot. I think if you watch it and you listen to the song, you'll see the beauty and you know the story. You know, I think stories go a long way. You know, the story of it is what's important. It's not just. My wife has a silly song in her head. It's my wife had a song for her son, you know,
it's a
different message and it hits a little harder and she drew a comic and she didn't draw it to go, oh, I'm going to sell this to cottage cheesemakers. She's like, I'm going to put my family in it. Cause I love my family. And I love what we built here and this beautiful thing. Like, and it's very touching. You know, art should be touching. Like, I think that sometimes, you know, especially you and me who do this, Tim, like some people, they just want to get things out there. They just want to do art, but they don't really have a lot to say. And that's okay. You don't need to have a lot to say, but some people really do. And I think that those should be seen. And I think, you know, when you go over this list too, like everything you mentioned, people really had something to say, really something that needed to be sung, that needed to be the extra little bit. And I think that those need to be rewarded and like looked at a little differently.
Well said, brother. And viewers, if you'd like to check out Travis's podcast, as you can tell by just talking to him, this is one that you'll feel in your heart. So I'd recommend it in the highest possible terms. And in closing, I just want to say, Travis, thanks for coming on the show, man. This was a real pleasure talking to you.
Oh, thanks. I had a great time hanging out.
Yeah, this is going to be a fun time. Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. You'll be on the green list. Okay. And just to our viewers, I want to say thanks again for tuning in. I appreciate your patronage. This has been an episode of Holden's 11, and we will see you next week on the next episode. Good night, everybody.